This is Bloomberg Businessweek. Insight from the reporters and editors who bring you America's most trusted business magazine. Plus, global business, finance, and tech news. The Bloomberg Businessweek podcast with Carol Messer and Tim Stenovec from Bloomberg Radio.
You're not the only one with mixed emotions.
Well, as I mentioned, stocks just keep going up. Continuing the week on a positive note, or kicking the week off on a positive note, I should say, buoyed by a burst of deals, even as Fed officials are kind of spending the last few days, a little bit over the weekend, sowing doubts that aggressive interest rate cuts are going to materialize next year. Here are a few of them. Chicago Fed President Austin Goolsbee, Cleveland Fed President Loretta Mester, they were the latest to join a growing chorus of central bank officials tempering market optimism after their New York counterpart John Williams last week said bets on a March reduction were premature. The equity market and the bond market are kind of ignoring them. Hey, we got a great roundtable to kick off our program this afternoon. John Authers is a senior editor for markets and a Bloomberg Opinion columnist. Elena Popina is equity markets reporter for Bloomberg News. Both of them are here in the Bloomberg Interactive Brokers studio. John, I want to start with you because your latest column talks about the really quick rally that we've seen and how, you know, I don't want to use this, throw out this term, but essentially the easy money has been made at this point. And if you're looking to buy right now, your big question is what's going to happen over the next decade?
Arguably, yes. I mean, at the moment, the Fed, if we believe the dot plot, thinks there's going to be three cuts next year, which is more than they were saying before. And the Fed funds futures markets thinks there are going to be six. So, it's hard to see how you get even lower rates than are currently being priced in unless something happens to shock the Fed into cutting far more than it currently wants to, i.e. if there's a recession which messes up equities.
So what happens if there is a recession, the Fed has to cut more aggressively? What do we see from equities?
One would imagine past experience has been that pivots tend not to be great for equities because they are pivoting for a reason.
Which is that
the economy is in trouble. If you have a pivot as in 2018 after the Christmas Eve massacre when Jay Powell stepped back from that was an unusual pivot in that was at a time when the economy wasn't in any particular trouble. And it just loosed the dogs of war. You had this fantastic rally the following year. That's obviously roughly what we've had again this time because the Fed is very unusually getting worried about whether it should be cutting rates soon with growth at over 5% and unemployment at less than 4%, which is, you know, unusual. I don't see myself how the current rate forecast is fulfilled, turns out to be accurate, unless the economy turns out to be much worse than is currently being predicted.
Elena Popina, come on in here. You are equity markets reporter for Bloomberg News. You joined us at the end of last week to give us an idea of what we saw when it came to week seven of gains for the S&P 500. Since then, you've spoken to quite a few sell-side analysts. What have they told you about how they're thinking about not just the next few days and the remainder of the year, but also what happens next year?
Yeah, thank you, guys. It's a pleasure to be here. You know, we are seeing quite a number of sell-side analysts boosting their target prices for 12 months from now. The ratio of upgrades to target prices to downgrades is now at the highest level since at least January 2022. That's the previous time the S&P 500 reached its all-time high. Now, whether or not, you know, analysts are just reacting to the stock market is gone up quite a bit in November and has gone up quite a bit in December so far is yet an open question. To John's point, there is quite a bit of a concern that there is a mismatch between what the dot plot shows and what markets are expecting in terms of the pace of rate cuts next year. But the positive sign is that the rally seems to be broadening out. For example, the equal-weighted S&P 500 index is on pace for its best year since April 2022 relative to the cap-weighted S&P 500. So it's not just the Magnificent Seven anymore. You know, the laggards, the relative laggards like value stocks are trying to outperform. So it gives more momentum and more breadth to the rally. But then, yes, again, there can be an argument made that the rally has become quite a bit of an overextended. So we could be due for some kind of pullback after New Year's.
What does history tell us about these types of pullbacks, John? I mean, I know you're not a technical analyst here, but in your experience, and I should note you're also chief investment officer of Hindsight Capital, so you have an idea.
With whom I've been in contact quite a bit.
Okay, so we'll wait to hear about Hindsight Capital later this year. But what has history told us about moves like this?
Generally speaking, when you get moves this dramatic, there is a risk actually of a melt up. I mean, in terms of what Elena was saying, the positive way to put it is that breadth has widened, which is good. The negative way to put it is that there's a dash for trash. So the meme stock index, the last time I checked, was up 40% in a month, something silly like that. Lots of
crypto's been high.
Yes, lots.
Kathy Wood's ARK Innovation ETF has had a great
and lots of small caps that really don't look in good financial shape in terms of their credit have rallied. Now that is a sign of breadth, but it's also a sign of, okay, let's just buy the really cheap stuff now because everything's going to rip. The scenario that worries me, because again I might be over applying what's happened in my experience, my career, is LTCM.
Long-term capital
in 98, which was, I think, the significant, the great error of monetary policy in since Volcker. And for those who don't know, LTCM was this huge hedge fund that began to melt down, got caught on the wrong side of all its trades after Russia defaulted in August of 98. The Fed organized, more or less forced all its banks, its creditors, to agree a bailout which didn't actually involve public money, which matters a lot at the time. The credit market stayed becalmed, and so Greenspan cut rates. And the most palpable turn in sentiment in a day I've ever witnessed was the day that Greenspan cut rates between meetings without warning on a Thursday afternoon. And I think, bank stocks were up more than 10% in the subsequent hour. And the globe.com went public about 2 weeks later. The NASDAQ more than doubled over the last year. At that point, it looked as though the great bull market connected to the dot-coms had just reached a natural peak and was beginning to slide down. And that fateful decision to pivot, which wasn't stupid, there were reasons to do it, that the fateful decision to pivot led to, the greatest melt-up of all time, whose consequences you could argue we're still dealing with. That strikes me. Eric Balkun has had this fascinating chart. Apparently Friday saw the biggest flows into SPY.
Oh, wow.
Ever. I've tried checking it in percentage terms, and there were a few bigger days during the real hurly-burly of the GFC, but in terms of actual money, more people put money into, or more money was put into SPY on Friday than on any other day ever before. That has the signs, as somebody who has arguably been too bearish and too conservative over the years, but that instinctively bothers me.
Okay.
I mean, it might mean you should buy now on a short time period, because wouldn't it have been fantastic to own stocks through the whole of 1999 and get out in time? And lots of people will make that calculation. But in terms of what that means for the economy and the health of the financial system over the next decade. That's concerning to me.
Hey, Elena, I want to give you the last word here and talk a little bit about what the analysts and you speak to tell you in terms of their bearishness, because it's kind of hard to find the bears out there right now, isn't it?
It is kind of hard to find. You know, we are looking at a number of sell side analysts being quite bullish on the next half a year, with a few exceptions like Mike Wilson, like a few other analysts. But what I wanted to mention is that the election year, historically, this century has so far seen some weakness in the middle of the year, in the second and third quarters of the year. We saw that in 2000. We saw that obviously in 2008. We saw quite a bit of that in 2020. Now, some may argue these were exceptional periods of time. And yes, I agree with that. But if history is any indication at this point, and I don't know whether that's going to be the case, we could see some pullback. And with stocks near record, we could be live for pullback sometime in the second or fourth quarter.
Elena Popina, equity markets reporter for Bloomberg News. John Authers, senior editor for markets and a Bloomberg opinion columnist here in our Bloomberg Interactive Broker studio. We're just getting started on this Monday afternoon. This is Bloomberg Business Week.
You're listening to the Bloomberg Business Week podcast. Catch us live weekday afternoons from 3 to 6 Eastern. Listen on Bloomberg.com, the iHeartRadio app, and the Bloomberg Business app. Or watch us live on YouTube.
Well, some public companies are still trying to figure out exactly how to comply with new rules from the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission requiring speedy disclosure of significant cyber attacks. Those rules, which kicked in Monday, require companies to report cyber incidents within 4 business days of determining that they are, quote, material to shareholders. The SEC previously required firms to disclose major events that would be of shareholder interest, but didn't specify cyber events. We did speak earlier on our program about cyber attack hurting orders for Vans, North Face, Dickies, Supreme, JanSport, Timberland owner VF Corp, and the way that those can really bring a company offline, especially at a crucial time like during the holiday season. Well, our next guest knows a thing or two about cybersecurity. Wendy Thomas is president and CEO of Secureworks, the cybersecurity company. She's back with us once again, joining us on Zoom from Atlanta, Georgia. Wendy, good to have you with us this afternoon. How are you?
Well, I'm doing well. Thanks for having me, Tim.
Well, thanks for joining us once again on this. It's a little different environment than when we last spoke to you just a few months ago, specifically when it comes to this new SEC ruling that requires speedy disclosure of significant cyber attacks. It seems like there's a lot of confusion with what exactly companies now have to disclose to their shareholders when it comes to cyber attacks. What can you tell us about it?
Sure. Glad to share the emerging insights into the new regulations. I think about it in sort of the front end and the back end. On the back end, as you mentioned, public companies now have to report cyber incidents that are determined by the company themselves to be material, which is a discussion in and of itself, within 4 business days. And so that's the primary back end requirement. But on the front end, the disclosures around everything from policies governing cybersecurity risks, the company's risk management processes, processes whereby management is informed about cyber incidents, and the board's oversight of that, all of those are now required to be disclosed in annual 10K filings by public companies. And so the scrutiny of whether we are preparing sufficiently for cyber incidents, as well as disclosure about them on the back end, is significantly ramped up.
I want to talk about this just because this one's in the news, but you could just replace VF Corp with, any given company at any given time. VF Corp suffered this cyber attack at pretty much the worst possible time in the most important quarter of the company. And it has hurt orders for Vans, North Face, and other brands that the company has. I'm wondering, how this stuff continues to happen when we understand that the threats are out there and so many companies are spending so much money on keeping their network safe.
They are spending significant amounts of money, but as you can see, the cyber criminal only has to be right once. And we have to be right in and out every day. And that's why it's so important for companies to have a security expert partner to help them prepare for and navigate situations like this to minimize the damage. There's nothing worse for a company than their high season to be impacted by this type of a cyber attack. And to be frank, the reason these regulations are in place is that when things like this hit the headlines, regulators feel compelled to incent companies to protect themselves proactively, and then to be straightforward with shareholders or investors around what may be impacting their business in terms of its operations or financial performance. And this is a case in point of why we see new regulations coming out around this.
In your opinion, do the regulations go far enough?
The regulations, I think, are a good first step in many ways, and I have no doubt we'll continue to see them evolve like many other new forms of rulemaking over the years. But what I will tell you is these regulations are not intended to punish. They are really intended to create the right incentives. Look, 2023, I think it's on track to be the most prolific year for ransomware ever, and to have one of the highest economic costs of security breaches to date. Right. This cybercrime is a ongoing, continual transfer of wealth to criminal enterprises. And so I think that the SEC feels compelled to provide guidance around how to better prepare for these types of situations going forward. And frankly, they've raised the bar for CEOs, CISOs, and boards of directors around preparing for these types of incidents.
What, in your opinion, is the right amount of money for a company to actually spend on keeping their company secure from cyber attacks? Not a single figure, but a certain, like, a portion of revenues, sure, for example, or a portion of expenses.
That does vary a bit, and I'm glad to provide some ranges there. It does vary a bit depending on whether the organization is in a highly attacked and frankly highly regulated industry.
Meaning like a healthcare or a financial services, for example.
Exactly. They have a much higher standard. Now, what we see is damages to companies that are more in the manufacturing and the retail space. So it does matter from a business uptime and financial performance perspective. But generally, we expect to see companies spending somewhere in the 4-5% range. It can sort of merge into other technology spend a little bit, because you can have secure by design technology deployments. But somewhere between that and, you know, 12-15% of your total technology spend is what we see typically in place, again, for businesses that aren't necessarily in a highly regulated industry.
Do you see that portion moving up?
I do see that portion moving up, but I also see it moving in terms of mix. So while you want to invest in preventing as much as you possibly can, what these regulations are showing is that you have to invest in you weren't able to prevent everything. So you absolutely have to be able to detect quickly, because with these regulations, the ability to assess the impact of an incident in terms of what it's going to do to your business operations and the financial outcomes of that, you absolutely cannot do that with humans alone. It requires technology investments and investments in awareness and preparation of your team. So I do think that the mix is going to shift quite a bit towards the detection and preparation aspect of this.
Wendy, we've talked a lot about AI in the context of making companies more productive and being able to be more efficient. We've talked about it too in the concept of people being worried about AI, sort of like the way that Elon Musk is concerned about AGI. I'm wondering how you've seen or how you could see threat actors use AI to pose as humans, to actually gain access to networks. What's worst case scenario here that you guys are thinking about over at Secureworks?
Sure. As we've talked about before, the power and the peril of AI is very real for cybersecurity. And so while the power of it to be able to detect certain behavioral techniques of the adversary are incredibly important for how we operate at Secureworks, We also see the adversary taking advantage of these tools and techniques as well. And I think the most near-term one that we have seen and increasingly concerns us in terms of its accelerated use is around deepfakes, with the ability to impersonate a CEO, not just in an email, but in a video, and to do that at scale with, you know, large language models like ChatGPT. It just has put a pace of deployment and a fidelity of believability in what they're using to deceive. It's just taken it to another level. And that's the primary area where we're focused on.
I mean,
the ability to detect.
Yeah, one hard thing is, you mean, you have to remain so vigilant regardless of who's, you know, in your organization, from person with access to certain systems versus just a person whose password or login credentials could be compromised. Wendy, we love it when you join us. Wendy Thomas is President and Chief Executive Officer of Secureworks, back with us on Zoom from Atlanta, Georgia. You're listening to Bloomberg Businessweek.
You're listening to the Bloomberg Businessweek podcast. Catch us live weekday afternoons from 3 to 6 Eastern on Bloomberg Radio, the Bloomberg Business app, and YouTube. You can also listen live on Amazon Alexa from our flagship New York station. Just say, Alexa, play Bloomberg 1130.
Well, the next guest has made his living connecting people. Sam Darwish is the co-founder, chairman, and CEO of one of the world's largest independent owners, operators, and developers of towers, providing communication infrastructure in 11 markets, serving about 770 million people. He joins us on Zoom this afternoon. He's the CEO of IHS Towers. It's got nearly 40,000 towers across Africa, Latin America, and the Middle East. Also the co-founder and chairman of the company. Good to have you with us this afternoon. Sam, how are you?
Good. Thank you. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing really well. Hey, this is perfect timing for you to come on our program, because our own Bloomberg technology team, Matt Day and team, wrote a piece about Project Kuiper earlier today, about Amazon's foray into providing high-speed internet. And he said, you know, Amazon's not just competing against SpaceX's Starlinks of the world. He's competing with anyone out there right now providing connectivity. And that's a company like yours that provides the infrastructure for connectivity. How are you seeing the landscape right now in the markets that you operate?
Look, we operate, as you said, we own 40,000 towers roughly across and fiber in the tens of thousands of kilometers, covering 8 or 9 million homes across our markets. Our markets are we operate in 11 countries across the world, covering roughly 800 million people, as you said. So we kind of like see the trends, understand what's happening. The likes of Amazon, the likes of Google, the likes of Facebook do from time to time come to our markets, trying to stimulate basically demand for their own services, but we haven't seen them come into our markets kind of like with big statements or with big projects that could move the needle. Now, having said that, at the end of the day, I get Starlink, I get all the projects or the ideas of trying to create connectivity using satellites or non-terrestrial systems, but when it comes to basic propagation, basic wireless, there is no alternate to a tower on ground.
Really? Why is that? Because, you know, here I am thinking to myself, this could be a prime moment for, you know, what you guys in the industry call leapfrogging here. The technology, you know, this infrastructure technology is so expensive. I don't have to tell you, you guys own and operate 40,000 of these towers. These are very expensive things to build and to operate. And then you have this other technology coming in that essentially broadcasts internet from the sky. Why is this not a serious concern to you at this point?
Because the technology has limitations. I'll list a few. The first is that as you're trying to penetrate a building or a structure sideways from a tower, it's much easier because you're kind of like going through windows and glass and this and that. If you try to do it from the satellite, you basically have to penetrate ceilings, like multiple ceilings. I mean, that's a lot. Given the distances also from the satellite to Earth, the satellite may be able to project the power, but the handset is kind of like small and it has limitations, and being able to penetrate back into the satellite, again, is another issue. What kind of spectrum do you use? Most of the carriers own the spectrum when you start interfacing with people. The size of the battery, how long can it last? I mean, those are practical limitations. And then compile that or add to all of this the fact that people need more and more and more capacity by the day, especially as some of these apps like drones, driverless cars, kind of like start to proliferate. We're going to need more capacity rather than less capacity. I mean, these satellites will not be able to provide that capacity.
Hey, Sam,
there are great solutions, Tim, like
right.
Offshore, rural, urban, mountains, provide some bridge like in the Ukraine situation, for example, but they can't be a solution to the millions of people using their phone, for example, in a Manhattan or a Los Angeles or a London or a Lagos.
Right. It's just, to, you know, apples and oranges, it certainly sounds like. Hey, Sam, I wanted to talk a little bit about the types of technology that these towers are providing. When you think about the different markets that you're in, are we talking 4G here? Are we talking 5G? I mean, what is the sort of standard in terms of the equipment that you provide or that the folks who lease and use your towers end up using?
Look, simply put, there is no difference in the aspirations of carriers and people in our markets to where the United States or Europe is. Everyone wants the fastest, cheapest pipe. Everyone wants 5G. Everyone wants fiber to the home. Now, having said that, we are definitely behind. Our markets are largely in the 4G cycle at the moment. Most of the 4G deployments have happened on our towers. They're selling it now to customers to upgrade from some markets 2G, 3G into 4G. Many of our markets like Nigeria, South Africa, Brazil have also seen 5G spectrum licensing recently. So we're beginning to see commercial trials or commercial pilots into 5G, but 5G is still not the standard. So it's largely 4G.
You guys offer six different solutions, including new sites, in-building solutions, fiber connectivity, small cell infrastructure in urban areas. Where are you most bullish for your company?
Look, for us, we think about it from a deployment point of view. What does the wireless network that carries a 4G or a 5G or eventually a 6G, what does it require? Initially, it used to require these macro towers, the big towers, you know, and that's what most of us and some of our peers, American Tower, Crown, SBA, focused on. But as rollout starts to change, especially with 5G, more small cells will be needed. The DAS becomes very important. Fiber is critical as small cells start to get closer to each other. So the fiber connection to those locations become important. Also, we're seeing now compute and cache becoming very important. At the end of the day, those towers are the closest real estate possible to the eyeballs using a cell phone. So an element of computing could happen, potentially some data center or edge data center on these locations. So what I'm trying to tell you here, there is no one size fit all kind of like solution. You have to be ahead. You have to look at the technology of the time in that country and what kind of rollout does it require. It always will require macro towers in our view, because that's kind of like the basic, the umbrella kind of coverage. But all these other types like small cells, like the in-building, like the fiber,
yeah,
will be required in different types and different instances.
Well, sure. Sam, I could talk about this stuff all afternoon. I used to cover telecom, so I just love talking about connectivity and how people are getting connected around the world. Really appreciate you taking the time and joining us on Bloomberg Business Week this afternoon. Sam Darwish, co-founder, chairman, and CEO of IHS Towers, joining us on Zoom this afternoon. This is Bloomberg Business Week.
You're listening to the Bloomberg Business Week podcast. Catch us live weekday afternoons from 3 to 6 Eastern. Listen on Bloomberg.com, the iHeartRadio app, and the Bloomberg Business app. Or watch us live on YouTube. Clap your arms, the beat start ticking.
Then you know you're doing the funky chicken. It's a good song for this, Paul Brennan. Doing the funky chicken. I like it. Well, it all sounds pretty great. Meat that's grown in a lab, it tastes exactly like chicken, beef, shrimp, pork, you name it. But without the downsides to raising livestock. No animals killed, no fisheries depleted, no harmful chemical climate emissions. So great that over the last few years, investors have poured nearly $3 billion into cultivated meat companies. By the end of the year, there were 156 companies working on it, according to the Good Food Institute. It's a nonprofit think tank for alternative proteins. You got big names, billionaires like Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos. You got Ashton Kutcher, Leonardo DiCaprio, state-owned investors pouring money in. And yet here we are. When families gather around the table this holiday season, the meat that many will eat will not have been grown in a lab. Deena Shanker and Priya Anand write all about the venture-backed startups, such as Upside Foods, that have promised cultivated chicken is the solution to the meat problem, and yet the challenges they've faced. The story is in the new issue of Businessweek magazine. It's available on newsstands now, online at Bloomberg.com/businessweek and on the Bloomberg terminal. With more, we've got Deena Shanker, consumer reporter for Bloomberg News, joining us on Zoom from New York. Also here, the editor of Bloomberg Businessweek, Joel Weber. He's here in our Bloomberg Interactive Broker studio. Joel, as the famous election slogan goes, a chicken-growing bioreactor in every home.
Yeah, there you go. So we've been really interested with sort of a line of reporting that Deena has done this year. Some of that was about fake meat, and that was a cover story earlier in this year. And then we also wanted to talk about and keep our eye on the lab-grown meat.
Not to be confused industry. With fake meat.
It's actual meat. It's cell-based meat. That got FDA approval, so all of a sudden we expected to see a ton of this stuff suddenly hitting the market. Only not that much actually made it to consumers. So Deena, rewind the clock a little bit and talk to us. We got that wind up from Tim about why we might want to be interested in cultivated meat, but how much money has gone into this space and what have we gotten for it so far?
So there's been nearly $3 billion raised for companies that are growing meat and seafood from cells extracted from animals. And as Joel said, there have been government clearances. Two companies so far, Upside Foods and Eat Just, have received clearances from the FDA and the USDA. And the expectation that these companies set was once they had all their regulatory business in order, they were going to get stuff out to restaurants, and we were just going to start seeing this build up and more of it coming. But instead, what we've seen is that Upside Foods is currently serving only 1 pound of chicken a month, and that's in 1 ounce portions to 16 people each month. And Eat Just was serving a bit more than that to one restaurant, but now they've actually stopped production. So they're not serving anything in the U.S.
Okay, so if I did want to try this, where would I go and what would it taste like?
You would go to Bar Kren in San Francisco. You'd have to get a reservation, which last I checked was not easy to do. You'd get your reservation and then you could get this very small 1 ounce portion. It's tempura'd and deep fried, and the reviews have generally agreed that it tastes like chicken. Some have said that it tastes like better than chicken they remember. Others are like, it tastes chickeny enough. So I think we could say the through line is it tastes like chicken, and you know, you take that for what it's worth.
Why is it why is it so difficult to do this at scale? If they can do 1 pound, why can't they do 10 pounds or 20 pounds or 100 pounds or 1,000 pounds?
So if you think about like, say like a cupcake recipe, and you're going to make a cupcake recipe, or as I was just doing in my house, potato latkes, you just double it, right? You just put in twice as much, and then it takes you maybe a little longer than the original recipe to bake it all or to fry it all, depending on what you're making, right? It's just not the same with cell culture. It's really tricky to get these cells to grow, and every time you increase the amount you're growing, you have to change other things, like what you're feeding the cells. And if you're changing the vessel, then that changes things too. And the cells might grow just fine in one kind of vessel and then not so fine in another. For Upside Foods, they were having success growing very small amounts in these plastic one-time use roller bottles that have been part of like the biopharmaceutical industry for decades and decades. But when they tried to move into their much larger steel tanks, they had a number of problems, including contamination issues. So they just couldn't get those tanks to work in any kind of reliable way. And they eventually just abandoned them and stuck with these very small roller bottles that we were told by former employees that for a single night at Bar Kren, for that 1 pound of meat, would use more than 100 of these one-time use plastic bottles. And by the way, Bar Kren is a certified plastic-free restaurant.
Yeah, some irony there. Deena, tell us more about Upside Foods, because this has been a multi-year odyssey with millions of dollars invested in it. So here we are at this point, but who's behind it and what are they still hoping that they can accomplish?
So Upside was founded in 2015. They call themselves the first cultivated meat company. They made huge promises about what they were going to do. They said they were going to be at Whole Foods by 2020 and Costco by 2021. They raised a lot of money. They've raised more money than any other company in the space, more than $600 million on all of these promises. They've raised money from Tyson. They've gotten money from all kinds of investors, including some of the more mission-driven investors that are really looking for sustainable solutions. And instead, what's happened is that they, even as they were going through the motions of these FDA and USDA clearances and saying publicly that they were ready to scale, they are just not ready to scale. They have currently a pilot plant that they said when they opened it would be capable right off the bat of 50,000 pounds a year, as they are currently selling only about 12 pounds a year, but they're already talking about their next commercial plant that's going to be 187,000 square feet. And capable, they say, millions of pounds of production a year.
Deena, Joel started off our interview by talking about the other stories that you've done about the faux meat companies, Impossible Foods, Beyond Meat. You've been covering this space for years. And one theme that's emerged in your reporting over the last couple of years is the alternatives to meat have not delivered on the promises that investors thought and that the companies communicated. And in the end, at the end of the day, it seems like people are going back to just regular old meat. And that is an issue for a lot of things. One, for animal welfare, and two, for climate change. Can you talk a little bit about just big picture what you've learned with these stories in terms of the staying power of good old fashioned meat?
Yeah, well, I think there's a few things. One is that we definitely see that there is tremendous interest in reducing meat consumption. There's interest from investors, there's interest from entrepreneurs, and there is interest from consumers as well. So that's definitely there. But people are not willing to make sacrifices on their food experiences, on foods that they love, to do something that they think is better for the environment or better for animals. And so people are willing to say, okay, maybe I'll pay a little bit more for this, but they're not willing to pay a little bit more if what they get is a little bit less than what they were trading it in for. So people are open to reducing their meat consumption, but I think they just haven't really been offered anything that is as tasty as meat. I would just like to plug caviar lentils. They are so good. They don't taste anything like meat, but they're really good and they're cheaper than meat and they're really great for the environment if you're looking to reduce your meat consumption. I really like them.
Okay, so you can buy them on Amazon. I am also curious, the strategy that Upside decided to pursue, which was to make chicken. Why chicken? Because chicken's already pretty affordable, and from a planetary standpoint, and we know that cattle have methane emissions and that are very intensive land use propositions, but like chicken, like why make a better chicken without the chicken?
Well, you know, chicken in the industry is generally seen as significantly easier to cultivate those cells than say beef cells. That's why we've seen a number of companies go with chicken. Some of them call it like a stepping stone to beef. Upside has not discussed it that way. Uma Valetti, the founder, told me years ago in an interview that a story involving his daughter loving fried chicken. People talk about chicken as, you know, everybody loves chicken. It's a really, you know, popular protein, but it just, not only is it not a particularly environmentally destructive protein, especially from a climate perspective, but it's also just really cheap. So trying to make a product that's going to compete with it on price is just really, really, really hard.
And so there's other efforts to do things other than chicken. How are those faring, and what do those competitors have to say about Upside's approach?
For example, cultivated seafood company Wildtype is making they're focused first on salmon. I will say I tried their salmon years ago and I found it to be very impressive. And they said that they told me that they thought chicken was strategically a bad idea because it's so cheap. Salmon is really expensive. If you ever go to a restaurant, like, the salmon is 100% guaranteed to cost more than the chicken, a lot more too. The oceans have their own, have plenty of issues, including overfishing, including microplastics, farm salmon has its own set of issues. It can be tricky as a consumer to find a piece of salmon that you feel like lives up to your values if you care about where your food comes from. So that's the way they're going. But they've also said, listen, they're moving along. Wildtype told me they are encountering their own problems, but they feel like they're making steady progress.
Well, speaking of steady progress, Deena, based on your reporting and all the reporting that you've done in this space, when do you think it's a realistic time that consumers can expect cultivated fish or cultivated poultry or cultivated meat to actually appear at scale?
He's asking for an interested party.
Yeah, I would eat this. Totally. I would totally eat this.
You know, a number of people have told me that they see an opportunity in this market. I've heard two different things that sound like feasible opportunities. One is these blended products. So maybe it's a mixture of animal fat, which has a lot of flavor in it, and with plant-based proteins. And then by using just a little bit of those cultivated cells with more plant-based proteins, you are really reducing costs and you are improving. So think like a Beyond Burger, but instead of tiny little Dippin' Dot style coconut oil fat balls, they're like actually beef fat balls or something along those lines. And that could, I mean, I haven't tried that. I can't speak to it, but that could theoretically taste a lot better and be available much sooner. And then other people have said that the opportunity is in like really high end meat. So like foie gras or something along those lines, where consumers are already expecting to pay a ton of money. And the amount that you have to produce to be considered widely available is significantly lower than you would have to produce for something like chicken or pork or beef.
Can't wait. Can't wait to watch the space.
We did this whole interview, Joel, and didn't talk about fetal bovine serum.
I mean, we still have time.
We do.
Or I could just run out the clock by speaking very slowly.
Let's just say that they're not completely animal-free products at this point.
Well, and stay tuned for more great reporting from Deena Shanker.
Yeah, Deena, always love it when you join us. And even if the story's about lab-grown meat, I still get hungry when we talk about it. Deena Shanker, consumer reporter for Bloomberg News, joining us on Zoom from New York. Also here, the editor of Bloomberg Businessweek, Joel Weber. Joel, would you eat this stuff?
If ever there's more than the little bit that exists in the world, I would try it.
One ounce
I would try it.
Per person.
I don't think I'm going to be seeing it anytime soon.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, but we'll see.
We'll see. You're listening and watching Bloomberg Business Week on Bloomberg Radio, on SiriusXM Channel 121, on Bloomberg Originals, and on YouTube. This is Bloomberg Business Week.
I'm driving in my car. I turn on the radio.
Yeah, how about you let me drive?
Oh, no.
Who's gonna drive you home?
Honey, please, I'll do the driving.
Drive on.
Excuse me, I wanna drive. You drive, stay
in prison. It's the question that drives us.
This is the Drive to the Close.
That funky music will drive us till the dawn.
On Bloomberg Radio.
All right, well, here we are, less than 18 minutes to go to the close of U.S. trading here on this Monday, December 18th, 2023. I'm Tim Stenovec. Carol Masser is out this afternoon. It is Bloomberg Business Week. It's time for Drive to the Close. For that, we go to Jay Jacobs, U.S. Head of Thematics and Active Equity ETFs over at BlackRock. He joins us on Zoom from New York City. Jay, good to have you with us this afternoon. Full disclosure to our audience, you and I sat next to each other in a few classes in business school. So that's how we know each other. And you're now at BlackRock and I'm here at Bloomberg and we get to talk ETFs a little bit. How are you?
I'm great. How are you doing, Tim?
Yeah, doing pretty well. Doing pretty well. Hey, did this rally, you know, you just heard the numbers from Charlie Pellett there. Did this rally over the last 8 weeks, did this catch you off guard?
I think it caught a lot of investors off guard because we've seen $6 trillion in money market funds in the United States this year, $8 billion globally. So a lot of people were looking at cash yields and thinking, I don't know what's happening in the markets. I don't like the risk out there of a recession or general volatility. I'm going to take 4 or 5% yield in cash and call it a day. And instead, we've seen the S&P is now up almost 25% on the year. That's the risk of holding cash. We know over the long run, participating in markets is key to investor success. Trying to time it can be very difficult, though. So I think this caught a lot of people off guard.
Yeah, trying to time it is a fool's errand. I mean, ask anyone who missed this rally here, Jay. That's the thing, though. There is still, you know, trillions of dollars on the sidelines right now in these money market funds, in these cash funds. How do you see that getting deployed in 2024?
I think the bar is high to bring that cash off the sidelines.
Really?
Investors have voted with their dollars this year. They've said they like the yield. If you're going to take money out of cash, out of a yield, you know, a yielding bank account and put it into the markets, you need to have a really compelling reason why. And so we are looking at really what are the specific areas that are exciting. I think the challenge, Tim, is if you look back over the last 10 years or so, we call it the Great Moderation. You know, interest rates were falling, growth was strong. It was really a great time to be in just a 60-40 portfolio. It almost didn't matter what you bought. Almost all assets were rising. But now in this higher volatility, high interest rate environment, you really have to get more precise about honing in on where the growth areas are in the market. And I think that's where investors are going to have to do their homework of looking at, I want to come out of cash, but what are the attractive areas? It's not just about broad benchmarks anymore.
Okay, so let's talk about the thematic outlook that you guys have over at iShares by BlackRock. You talk about this higher bar. I know you're also really interested in AI. And if we characterize 2023 and, you know, really, if there's one way to describe 2023, it's certainly the year when investors started paying very close attention to AI. And we saw some big winners, NVIDIA, Microsoft, and even some startups like OpenAI as well. How are you guys thinking about AI in 2024?
We see AI in 2023 as really just the proof of concept year. ChatGPT burst onto the scene. A bunch of people played around with the technology, but not a lot of commercial adoption. You haven't seen billions of dollars in revenue coming to a lot of these AI companies yet. So 2024 is going to be that year of commercial success where this technology is proven and you're going to start to see more enterprise applications for AI as well as more consumer applications. I think just an example, you know, we've seen some companies already say they expect to save hundreds of millions of dollars in client service because now they can use AI to respond to basic questions. You know, how do I reset my password? Where do I find my account information? And they can, you know, really use AI for kind of that low-hanging fruit questions from clients, whereas using their more sophisticated human answers for the more sophisticated questions. So, in fact, about 60% of CEOs who intend to use more AI next year have said they want to do so for cost-saving measures. So if we're in a tight economy and AI is looking really promising as a technology, I think we're going to see much more investment in it for companies to bring down their cost base.
So what are the types of companies that end up being the beneficiaries there? Let's say that, you know, people are saying to themselves, well, wait a second, you know, we know that NVIDIA has done really well this year, but now we enter the part of the AI revolution where we start to see companies, as you mentioned, embrace this technology and lead to real cost savings. Which are the types of companies that are going to do that?
Yeah, we really have to look across the AI tech stack to find those companies. So at the basic level, you look at the hardware. Those are the semiconductors that are really powering these AI systems. It includes some of the really powerful GPU manufacturers, but also includes several of the CPU manufacturers that can be really efficient for AI processing. One level above that, you can look at digital infrastructure. Where is all these semiconductors being housed? You know, AI doesn't just happen in the air, in the cloud. It has a physical location where these calculations are happening. It's the data owners. Data is the fuel into AI. So the companies that own the most data, have the most valuable data, are sitting, you know, potentially on really valuable information there. And then finally, at the highest order, these are the companies that are building applications using AI. So if we take a step back and look at, you know, the last decade or so, a platform technology that built many businesses was 4G technology. It allowed us to get data faster on our cell phones anywhere where we were in the world. That allowed for things like mobile e-commerce, mobile social media, so that we could stream videos and shop wherever we are. The new platform technology for the next 10 years is going to be AI. What is the next e-commerce? What is the next social media that's going to be built on top of that technology?
Hey, what about when it comes to just geopolitical events and demographic changes that you see happening and that you guys are planning for in terms of your the products that you offer at iShares by BlackRock? Let's talk presidential election in the next year. I mean, how should investors be thinking about that?
Well, I actually think this goes beyond the presidential election. If you look at really from the end of World War II through the global financial crisis, you saw globalization really in one direction, more and more globally integrated trade. But over the last few years, you've started to see new industrial policy in the United States with things like the Infrastructure Investments and Jobs Act, the CHIPS and Science Act, the Inflation Reduction Act, all ways to build more critical industries in the United States, like semiconductors and electric vehicles. And that means that we need a lot more manufacturing, but we also need a lot more partner countries that can help us build all those things. Earlier this year, Mexico became the biggest trade partner of the United States. Huge landscape shift there. We've seen more trade with India and, frankly, reduced tariffs with India as we're looking to diversify supply chains into other countries around South and Southeast Asia. So as we try to build more and really secure key industries in the United States, it also comes down to who are the partner countries that the United States wants to work with for these new supply chains.
Jay, we only have like 20 seconds left, but given that we're up almost 25% on the S&P 500, are you bullish overall next year?
I am. I think I'm very optimistic that a lot of the cash on the sidelines is going to find these attractive areas like AI, like geopolitical fragmentation and our aging populations.
All right, Jay, really appreciate you joining us. Happy holidays if we don't connect before now and the next couple of weeks. Jay Jacobs is U.S. head of thematics and active equity ETFs over at BlackRock. He joins us on Zoom from New York City.
This is the Bloomberg Business Week podcast, available on Apple, Spotify, and anywhere else you get your podcasts. Listen live weekday afternoons from 3 to 6 Eastern on Bloomberg.com, the iHeartRadio app, TuneIn, and the Bloomberg Business app. You can also watch us live every weekday on YouTube and always on the Bloomberg Terminal.